हेलो चेक, हेलो हेलो हेलो। हेलो 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 चेक 1 2 3 4।
गुड मॉर्निंग। इज इट ओके? इज इट ओके? हाँ सो द बिफोर आई गो टू द अदर डिजाइन्स आई थॉट इट्स इम्पोर्टेंट टू रिवाइज द कॉन्सेप्ट्स व्हिच वी डिस्कस सम टाइम अगो, बट मेनी ऑफ यू वर नॉट देयर पर्हैप्स। सो it will be good to go through it again before we go on to other study designs like cohort or case control or cross-sectional studies, because the concepts become easy to grasp in randomized control trial. So if you remember, we discussed last time, if some of you were there, we discussed a concept called power. So do you recall what we meant by power of a study? So let's go through it, because I know it's long. So typically, when you look at book, then you see formula like this. Shouldn't I make it a slideshow? So you will see formula like this, which is for clinicians very frightening. Something like this about the power. So it's easy for the statisticians, but difficult for clinicians. You know, something like this. So when I was reading this, I was really very frightened. So after I learned everything, I thought it should be done something which a grade 3 math will be able to do it. and that's where we are going to go. So let's say we are going to do a randomized control trial where there are two groups of equal size. And you can make it equal size because you are planning it. You see, when you are doing a cohort study, you may not have equal size. The exposed group may be smaller than the non-exposed group. So that is a difference you have to keep in mind. Then we are talking of parallel group design. Last time we talked about parallel group, crossover, factorial, and so on. So those designs will come later, but we are talking of parallel group design. And suppose the hypothesis is that in patients with observations of patients over time, it may be simple natural history study in a cohort, a descriptive study, it may be a retrospective data analysis, but this comes from previous experience or prior studies. Where does 20% come from? 20% is your hypothesized outcome or event rate, which is going to persuade people to change their practice. So it is clinically meaningful and it is feasible. If it is not feasible, then you are overestimating the effect of intervention. If it is feasible but not persuasive for patients and treating physicians to accept, then also it's meaningless to conduct the study. So 20% difference is what you think is feasible with this intervention and also clinically meaningful, so much so that it will persuade clinicians and patients to accept the new intervention. So it may be completely based on your experience or based on even prior studies where some descriptive studies show that really surgery makes a difference of 20%, or it may be based on a survey which you ask patients and physicians how much difference will persuade you to accept the new intervention. So that's how it comes. Now, then the math is very simple. For superiority hypothesis, find out average of 40% and 20%. We call 20% as PE for the sake of abbreviation, which is those who are exposed to surgery get 20% death rate, whereas those who are in the control group, they get 40%. So take average of the two, 40 plus 20 divided by 2 is 30%, and then find out the difference between the two, which is exposed group and control group, which obviously gives you 40 minus 20, which is 20%. Now let's call this 30% as P and 20% as D. And then if you remember again, average of those who are exposed, those who are in the control group, mortality is 30%, difference is 20%. So sample size per group is given by 16P into 100 minus P divided by D into D. Okay, so please do the calculation and tell me, and those who are connected online, they can put their number on the chat box. Anybody is looking at the chat box? So if they do some calculation and come up with a figure, just don't say it now, but I will ask you later. You got the answer? What is it? 168 is total, right? 84 per group. So what she has done is multiplied it by 2, right? Anybody on chat box also got this? You are right. 16 into P is 30, 100 minus 30 is 70, divided by difference which is 20 into 20, 84 per group, right? So since there are two groups of equal size, as we said, so total becomes 168. So very good. So already know how to calculate sample size for randomized trial, which is parallel group design, 1:1 allocation, superiority hypothesis, right? So this is what you have to remember. It's not difficult to remember. And you, the use of this is that when I used to take rounds and ask residents what thesis you want to do, so they will say, nobody has tested clopidogrel in acute ischemic stroke, so I want to do it as a thesis. I said, how much difference it is likely to make and how much difference will persuade people to accept it. He will say, oh, because aspirin does it 1% difference, so let's take 2% difference. So now you do the calculation. It requires 20,000 sample size. Will you be able to do it in 3 years? No, I can't do it. So bright ideas do come. But just sitting around a coffee table, you can immediately show that it is not feasible. That's the utility of this. Every resident can do their own calculation. And every doctor can do it so that they plan their study, which is feasible. This is why people don't take up many studies which are obvious or already written in Cochrane reviews, in guidelines. There is no data about this. Everybody knows, whole world knows it. But why don't they do the study? Because it requires large sample size, which they think will not be possible for them to collect. Superiority, because suppose your hypothesis is equivalence hypothesis, then the formula will remain the same, the percentages will change. Because in equivalence hypothesis, you are saying those who are exposed to treatment and those who are not exposed to treatment will have the same rate, event rate. So there is no question of average, it will be the same. So that same figure will become P. If you think they are exactly equivalent, that means you are talking of no. So if it is not possible, then what do you do? You say that, well, if there is a difference of 2%, we will ignore it and consider that both are equivalent. Right? So that is called equivalence margin. So that margin, you have to decide how much difference will still be told or accepted as if there is no difference, right? So that is why superiority hypothesis is important. We can come to equivalence hypothesis later on. Not difficult, it is the same formula. Yeah. No, we are not talking of confidence interval. We are just talking of percentages, right? So proportions, probability, percentages, risk, all are same thing. So risk of mortality in control group, risk of mortality in experimental group, also called experimental group risk or control group risk. So now, suppose you have to do this. This is your hypothesis. Dexamethasone adjunctive therapy reduces mortality from 15% to 5% in children with neonatal meningitis. This is your hypothesis. What will be the sample size? Can you do the calculation? You did it already? $144 total or per group? Per group. Okay. Anybody got a different answer? Anybody got a different answer? No. So you are right. I think 15 minus 5 is 10, right? And average of this will be 10. So 16 into 10 into 90 divided by 10 into 10. So 10, 10 will cancel, 0 and 90, 0 will cancel. So 16 into 9, 144 per group. Not difficult, no? Right, so now you know it. So remember this, 16p into 100 minus p divided by d into t. And then remember, this is for superiority hypothesis for a study with two equal size parallel groups, right? If it is crossover, sample size comes to nearly half. We are not discussing that today. So you know it now. Any question? Yes, so there is a publication which is now in National Medical Journal of India, which I wrote. You can give that reference, right? So nobody is going to say, where did you get this? Any other question? Right. So where does the 16 come from? Right. That is something which is very automatic. So does anybody remember where does the 16 come from? So when I was giving this talk in Singapore, this is what they asked, where does the 16 come from? So I said, I went to Himalayas and terrorized by these equations. I prayed like what happened in Hindu mythology, then when the gods were terrorized by demons, then at least the leader of the gods called Indra or somebody went to Himalayas and did years and years of what they call tapasya. Then God became very pleased and said, what do you want? And then they used to give some kind of blessings which will win the demons, and therefore gods were happy. So I was terrorized by the equations, so I did the same. And in Himalayas, God became happy and said, to make you cheerful, let this 16 be with you. Right? So from that time, 16 is what I am using. But seriously, I will like to know something about your knowledge about diagnostic test before we go on to where the 16 come from. So you know that in diagnosis, if you are evaluating a new test, then you have to have a gold standard which gives the confirmed diagnosis, which is disease is present or disease is absent. Whereas test also gives you positive or negative, like RTP, like let's say rapid antigen test, positive for COVID-19, negative for COVID-19. And suppose you are testing against some gold standard, some people think RT-PCR may be gold standard, whatever may be the reason. So if test is positive and disease is also present, then what do we call it? True positive, right? If test is positive but disease is absent, false positive. If this test is negative but disease is present, false negative. And if test is negative and disease is also absent, then right. So remember, these are the results of the test, right? And if we take an example of 400 sample size, and we find figures like this, and these are the numbers we got from the study, right? Now, 190 out of 200 have got the disease, 160 out of 200 don't have the disease. They have negative test results, and 190 of those who have the disease has positive test result. Now you can convert it into percentage. So 190 will be out of 200, who have disease, 190 are positive. So that will be how many percent? 95%. And 160 out of 200 who don't have disease are negative, which is 80%. So 10 in this another column will be 5%, and 40 will be 20%. Yeah. So once you have death, you do this 95%, 20%, 5%, 80%. So this is a step forward. First was only the number, now it is the percentage, right? So now the same words like true positive, false positive cannot be used. Now you have to use another word which they use, true positive rate, false positive rate, false negative rate, and true negative rate, right? Because this is no more the number. These are expressed in percentages, right? So percentages should be called probability, but it has become ingrained in literature that people call it rate, right? Rate is not truly rate, but it is called rate. True positive rate, false positive rate, false negative rate, true negative rate. Then next stage comes that, you have to give, this is too long a name, true positive rate, false negative rate, false positive rate, true negative rate. So anybody knows what name has been given to true positive rate? Sensitivity. And true negative rate? Specificity. And any name given to false positive rate? No, false positive rate is in a diagnostic test, it is false positive rate, right? That's right. So sensitivity and specificity, these are the two terms. Otherwise, in a diagnostic test, there is no name given to false positive rate and false negative rate. Sensitivity has a word, specificity is a word for true negative rate. Now, why people didn't give name to false negative rate and false positive rate in a diagnostic test? Because if you know that true positive rate or sensitivity is 95%, then you know what the false positive rate will be, right? So you don't have to remember another number or another term. So this is what we use in diagnostic test. But not to forget, remember there is a relationship between false negative rate and sensitivity, right? And that relationship is that if sensitivity is 95, then false negative rate is 5%. If sensitivity is 80%, then false negative rate is, that's right. Remember this. This is how it runs. So if sensitivity is 84%, which means 84 out of 100 with disease are positive, then false negative rate will be 16%. Yes, that's right. Now, when you are doing a randomized control trial, then you are also doing almost like a diagnostic test. Now, you have to take your, mind around this to understand that actually you are trying to diagnose what is the truth, right? In truth, does the treatment make a difference compared to placebo? Or does treatment A make a difference compared to treatment B? This is also a type of diagnostic exercise. But unfortunately, there is no gold standard to reveal the truth. And what the truth is, whether the treatment really works or not, is only known to God. We don't know. There is no way to know. So any study you can take like a diagnostic test as if it is an attempt to find the truth, right? Now, so same exercise. If the truth is that treatment works and study find that treatment works, works means makes a difference, that means it will be, if treatment works and truth is that it treatment works and your study also find it works. That means true positive. Yes, it is a true positive conclusion. Similarly, if study find that a treatment works, but in truth it doesn't work, That means your conclusion is false positive. Study finds that it doesn't work, but in truth it works. False negative. And again, similarly, study finds that treatment does not work, but in truth it works. That means it is true negative. Same phenomenon. So, false positive and false negative, these are the two places where you make errors. Isn't it? Otherwise, these are true positive, means you got the right answer. True negative conclusion, you got the right answer, but if your conclusion turned out to be false positive or false negative, that means you are making errors. So, the error obviously should be called false positive error and false negative error, right? Nothing, no big deal about this. So, the name which is assigned to false positive error is called type 1 error. And false negative error is type 2 error. So, as you know, I asked them, why did you name it type 1, type 2? You just leave it as false positive error, false negative error. Then my statistician friends, they say, well, we have to give another name so that we can ask questions in exam. What is type 1 error? What is type 2 error? And then fail the students, right? It will be too easy for them to remember false positive, false negative. Then there is no question about what it is. So, whatever may be the reason, remember, these are the results of the conclusions. Just as you jumped from number or results to percentages, here also you have to jump from number or result to percentages. So, remember that false positive result will be type 1 error, false negative type 2 error. You cannot plan completely for error-free results. So, when I was doing a thesis and went to head of biostatistics to find out what is the sample size required, then he said, how much type 1 error you are willing to incur? I said, I don't want any error in my study. Doing a study in All India Institute of Medical Sciences, you are talking of error, is not understandable to me. This is no, you, which means you don't know, you come and attend my classes. So he said, it is not possible to plan without some probability of error. So when you convert this error into percentages, it will be probability. False positive error probability, probability of false negative error. So often questions are asked, how much false positive error probability is acceptable to you? Well, as I told you, I told my professor, I don't want to accept anything. He said, you don't know, you come and attend my classes. So after that, I learned that everybody accepts 5% false positive error probability, right? Probability is not the result, it is the probability in percentage. So I thought, okay, 5% is good enough. Then he said, how much probability of type 2 error you want to accept? So I said, 5%, if I am going towards false positive, why not same number for false negative? So I said, 5%. He said, get lost. You have not done your homework. You will never be able to complete your study in 3 years. So you go and read. So I came back again and found that everybody is accepting 10% and many studies are accepting 20%. And then he said, between 10% and 20%, I was confused. But then professor clarified that you take 20% because you are doing a 3-year tenure, your job. Hopefully you will be able to complete it if it is 20% probability of type 2 error. So, the name which is given to probability of false positive error is called alpha, and probability of false negative error is called beta. So again, if you ask the same question to your friends, statisticians, they will tell you same answer, that we have to label something, beta and alpha, so that we can ask questions to students. What is alpha? What is beta? Right? Otherwise, it is okay to remember probability of false positive error, probability of false negative error, because it is too long, so it is an abbreviation, alpha and beta. So now that we know the language alpha and beta, how much alpha we accept and how much beta we accept? He says 80%. How much beta you accept? 20%. 20% is reasonable, and 10% will be very good. So now again think of relationship between false negative rate and sensitivity. And this figure which I had given, that now it is just the other way around. If beta is 5%, then sensitivity would have been 95%. If beta, which is false negative, remember, false negative is beta. If it is 10%, then probability of true positive is, yeah. So if you remember that way, then easy to say that the word sensitivity is replaced in this conversation by power. So what is power then? Power is the probability of true positive, which means if beta is false negative error probability, power will be 100 minus beta. So beta is 10%, then power is 90%. Beta is 20%, then power is 80%. So when you have to state what power is, then you have to say that if in truth treatment makes a difference, then probability of finding a true positive conclusion is 80% or 90%. That is power, right? So that is what you ought to know when you are planning the study. So I told you that usually we take 5% alpha and beta as 20%, 10%, rarely 5%. So we have done this exercise where if 20% is beta, then power is 80%. If 10% is beta, then power is 90%. The 16 which comes is based on this alpha of 5%, beta of 20%, which means power of 80% with allocation ratio 1:1 in a parallel group randomized control trial. Now, in one of the lectures, the person asked, still I'm not sure, how did you combine all these things and get 16? I said, then you have to go back to this, right? And put the numbers Z1 alpha by 2, etc., etc., and then you do the calculation, everything comes to 16. So do you want to do it? He said, no, I don't want to do it. So just remember, somehow 16 comes if you do this calculation. Any question? If you don't have any question, then I have a question. What if I want 90% power? Right? What if I want 95% power? I gave you only for 80%. So this is what you do. If you have alpha of 5% and 80% power, then the factor to be multiplied with is 16. But when it becomes 90% power and alpha is 5%, then 21. So these two are very common ones. Rest are very rarely used, but it gives you a good idea why you need to specify your power and alpha and not be too ambitious, because you calculated in the bacterial meningitis example, 144 per group. If it was 90% power, then it will be 21 into 9, right? So it becomes 189 per group, isn't it? So you see, from 144, it jumps to 189. So almost you can say 90 patients more are required. When it goes to 95%, you have to multiply by 90, 26, and so on. So this is why we don't ask a very ambitious question. Now, so what we have done is we went through the concepts of hypothesis testing, which is similar to studies of diagnostic test, type 1 error, type 2 error, alpha, beta, power. And also, who knows the truth? Only God knows the truth, right? So we don't know how many of studies which have been reported are actually still false positive or false negative. Now we have done an exercise that from some published, from Stata. Amit, you have some Stata example, no? You want to show? So come and show. So you do the calculation and see whether it tallies with. So can you do it with this calculation or not? Our calculation and calculation in Stata. So you are going to do the calculation first. You will ask them to do, no? First let them do, then you do. So let's say we are talking of same dexamethasone in COVID patients. Without dexamethasone, suppose mortality is 30%. With dexamethasone, suppose it comes down to 20%, let's say. Then what sample size is required? Can you do the calculation? 30% to 20%. How much does it come to? Thirty percent to 20%. 30% mortality without dexamethasone. If you give dexamethasone, 20%. Let's say, for example. Yes? 300 in each group for 80% power? 80% power. So 16 into 25 into 75 divided by 10 into 10. Can you do this in Stata? So remember, it is a ballpark figure. Don't be stuck to n per group is 294. And you said how much? 300. So Stata also gives the same. I didn't show this to you earlier, but if you whether Stata is in your mind, if you want to use this formula, you don't have to wait for software. You can do it on your own, right? If you want to take maybe another example, let's say surgery in intracerebral hemorrhage, mortality without surgery is 50%, and with surgery, it becomes 30%. 40% becomes 30%. 40% becomes 30%. 40 and 30. So it will require calculator. Sixteen into 35 into 65. How much it came? 364. Right, let's see what does Stata say. 356. Close? Don't be stuck to one or two patients, right? It is a any sample size calculation is a rough estimate. If it was absolutely right, then there will be no study which will be stopped after interim analysis. Why do they stop after interim analysis? Because they overestimated the sample size. Sometimes they extend a study. Why do they extend a study? Because they underestimated the sample size. And if you see number of studies which are terminated before the end of the study, there are so many. And therefore, which means so many times, the number which you come up with is not exactly correct because these percentages don't match to the reality. Therefore, don't be stuck with one or two patients. In fact, you will find sometimes if it comes to 94 per group, they will say, okay, we will take 200 patients. Because these are all rough estimates. Second thing which we do is you adjust these numbers to losses to follow up. Because suppose 10% will be lost to follow up. So you suppose you need 360 patients for your study per group, which means 720. So to get 90, you have to get 100 patients. So to get 720, you have to have 720 multiplied by 100 divided by 90, right? Like unitary method, which means 720 divided by 0.9. So whatever comes the number, that is the sample size you will come work with, right? So this is very close to Stata and works very well. Where is the reference? Can you give the reference, Amit? I told you to make a slide of the reference so that they don't have to... next slide. So this is the what I have published. In fact, the editor of NMJI and myself both were conducting a workshop. And I think it was somewhere in Himachal. So after they found that people are so, it's become so easy for people to calculate, he asked me to write it. And I wrote it, but the reviewers were very angry. Right? Reviewers were angry because I was simplifying too much, right? And they were saying, no, what is the need for this? There is already a calculator in the internet. No simplification is required. This is oversimplification and so on. But anyways, since editor had seen how people feel empowered to do it when they have a simple thing like this, I told him, look here, no reviewer, particularly who will be the reviewer? Imagine, some statistician, and I'm taking away their importance, you see. So people will not like it. But he said, don't worry, I will publish anyway. So he published it. There was another criticism. Our paper also contained for cohort study, case control study, and cross-sectional study, right? So the reviewer said it is too long a paper. It doesn't deserve so much space in National Medical Journal of India. So I said, okay, I will cut it and put only for randomized trial. And later on, we will submit another paper for cohort case control and this cross-sectional study. He said, okay, you don't need to do that, but anyway, if you want to do it, it's okay. So I have yet to submit this one. Yes. Yes, you suppose COVID started and we didn't know what will be the mortality, right? So you think of a range of, so maybe, first of all, you have to have a rough estimate that if we don't give dexamethasone, let's say 10% will die, right? But I may be wrong, it may be 20%, it may be 30%. And how much difference you expect dexamethasone to make? 5%, 2%, 10%? So for all the possible ranges, you make a sample size calculation, right? And and then you say that I will take the largest sample size for the study. You can always adjust later on, right? If your estimate was wrong, then you will do interim analysis and stop the study because you got better effect than you estimated. But if you plan for a smaller study, then you lose the chance of detecting because your conclusion will be false negative, isn't it? That you don't want. So some research proposals contain a table. If this is the percentages in the control group, this is in the experimental group, this is the sample size required, like that. Then they will say, okay, I'm going to take the largest of the sample size. Nobody can question, right? So when you don't know anything, you have to do on estimation basis. I should also say that if you are to do factorial design, you can do calculation for, I told you last time, no? Factorial design means you are studying two interventions in one study. First you randomize A versus placebo, then you randomize B versus placebo. So some people get A and B both, some people get only A, some people get only B, some people get nothing, right? Neither A nor B. So you can do a calculation. Think about what comparisons you will do. You will do A versus placebo, B versus placebo. Do sample size calculation for both. Whichever is larger, you take. If you take larger number, nobody can complain. Because what will happen if you take larger number? Only confidence interval will be narrow. But it is always good because then you can do subgroup analysis also. That is the thing. If you Some criticism will be that people are unnecessarily being subjected to study. But since the other question requires this, so you can do it, or you can do interim analysis and stop first drug trial and continue with the second. This is what happened in this COVID trials, no? Recovery trial, or they had multiple interventions. They kept analyzing and stopping some studies and continuing other studies. Because they had no idea when they were planning it. So you can do that. Every sample size which we calculated, you remember it was written two-sided. Two-sided means the treatment may actually harm or treatment may actually benefit. The study will give you both answers, whether treatment is harmful or treatment is beneficial. So it is two-sided. No, two-sided is, two-sided means both sides are being examined, benefit as well as harm. If you, this is what changes when you do non-inferiority study, then you say that I'm sure about one thing, that it will not do better than if there are two treatments, A and B. You are saying, I know that the new one, A, will not be better than B. But it will not be inferior to B. Which means you are not interested to know whether it is better because you are convinced it can't be better, right? You only want to know it is not worse. In which case, you don't have to do two-sided. It will be one-sided. So sample size comes down. But because of the margin, how much less is ignored or how much less is negligible, that increases the sample size. So in general, the sample size of non-inferiority trial will be larger, but not always, not always. some antibiotic. No, sometimes it is bigger, but they are bringing non-inferiority because they know it can't be superior, right? But if they bring non-inferiority or show non-inferiority, but less toxicity or less cost, then they have a market. So the non-inferiority has become a favorite thing because one thing is that most of the time they are not sure that it can be better. They want to show non-inferior, so physicians will know this and this, both are same, whichever is less toxic, less side effect, less costly, this is what they will use. So we need to have a separate session for non-inferiority trials, right? So again, it depends on your hypothesis. That if your hypothesis is that IV route will be superior to oral, then you have superiority hypothesis, right? Otherwise, why will you give injection to anyone, right? If it is working with oral route, you don't want to give injection, which is painful, unless it is superior to the oral one. So this will require superiority hypothesis again. Parallel group, two groups, and then do this sample size calculation will work. But pilot, why do you want to do pilot trial? Well, it's the same medicine. So if this is why somebody said that, look, first do some rough sample size calculation. Then it helps you to estimate the budget which is required, right? And ask the funder, are you willing to fund this much? Right? If he says yes, then only write the proposal. Otherwise, don't write. Very good advice, I think. He said, before you submit a proposal, writing a proposal takes a month, right? Before you do that, use this 16p into 100 minus p divided by d square, do a sample size calculation. It will give you some number. Do a rough costing. Right, back of the envelope costing, as they call it. And then approach the funder. Do you have funds up to this or my trial or one trial? If he says possible, then only write the proposal. If he says no, then don't write the proposal. Right? That is one. Secondly, if funder comes to you and says, you please do this study for me. So again, do the sample size calculation. See whether his fund, how much fund you are going to give. Suppose he says 20 lakhs. So you do the calculation. Say 20 lakhs will not meet the required sample size. Don't do the study. Right?
But if you are going to a new trial, and if you are going to a new trial and there is no confined result on that. So first you have to do pilot study that to show that, then you will get the funder, na sir?
Pilot study is done, yes, pilot study is important for different purposes, sometimes to show feasibility, sometimes to show whether it is acceptable or not, sometimes to check if there is some very unexpected toxicity or side effect. So I told you, we did when we proposed, yeah, microdosing study or dosing regimen, which dose you are want to use. So many reasons why you do pilot study, and for each one you have to plan differently and for different sample size. On the chat box, are there any questions?
Sir, there is one question. Dr. Vivek Verma is asking, sir, why we always fix alpha?
Question is, why 5% is almost always taken? I think this is universal agreement on this, but it is not necessary. If you see this, there is a calculation for alpha of 1% also, right? If alpha is 1% and 80% power, then 16 becomes 23. You can imagine that more than what it is asking is, for alpha of 5% and 90% power, the multiplication is to be done with 21. But if it is 1%, then it is 23. So now you know why people fix alpha of 5%? Because the sample size will become huge. And since everybody in the world has accepted that 5% false positive rate is acceptable, nobody raises any question. So it is a general universal, you can say, acceptance of 5%, which is makes it almost like fixed. There is nothing fixed. You can plan for 1% also, alpha of 1%. So question is, if a trial is blinded, then how interim analysis is done? So suppose I am doing a trial of A versus B, right? Or A versus placebo. So placebo has made us all blind. What we say to the analyst is that there are two arms, A and B, and see if there is any difference between the two. I don't tell him which one is placebo, which one is experimental drug. So he doesn't know. But he conducts an analysis just to check if there is a difference between the two arms. It is the same analysis, right? Suppose he finds a difference. In interim analysis, suppose he finds a difference. Now, difference may be because experimental drug is coming superior to the control or placebo, or it may be the other way around. Placebo is coming superior to the drug because drug is killing people, right? If it is mortality is the outcome. So after if there is no statistically significant difference, the data monitoring committee will say continue the study, don't stop. If there is a small difference, then also they will say continue the study, right? P-value of 0.04, for example, or 0.05 will not ask you to stop. If it is less than p-value 0.001, then say, hold on, something is going on. We want to know what is A and what is B. Then the code is broken, right? Code is broken. Then if they find that actually study is killing people, stop it because of harm. If study is better than the placebo, then stop it because of benefit. If there is no difference or mild difference, a small difference, continue the study. So there are stopping rules. At least I know of three rules, Pito's rule, O'Brien and Fleming rule, and there is Pocock's rule. There are three rules. But the one which is most commonly used is O'Brien-Fleming rule, which says first analysis, if p-value is less than 0.001, then you stop, otherwise don't. Second analysis, if p-value is less than 0.01, then okay. But then when you do like this, then last analysis, it will be measured for significance against p-value of less than 0.04, not 0.05. So more analysis you do, more stringent your last analysis will become. So what is the advice? General advice is do two interim analysis at the most, or do only one. And stop the study only if p-value is less than 0.001. If not, continue the study till you complete the sample size, then do the analysis. You may still be able to use p-value of less than 0.045 to declare significance. There are slides for how to adjust for interim analysis. I think I have given that in the paper also. It's given them in the paper also. What is the role of P? Yes. How much false negative error you are willing to incur? That is the question. And you can't have 30%, for example, beta. Nobody will accept, right? So 20% is acceptable for residence thesis. Most of the journals, means good journals, have published studies with 10% beta, 90% power. But 80% also is generally accepted. Any other question on the chat box?
Sir, yes, sir. Okay. I got that one, and I feel that you uploaded also on Google Scholar. There is determinants of outcome in chronic inflammatory demyelinating polyneuropathy, a longitudinal study.
I haven't seen, so go ahead.
So I can't purchase that one article, so I would like to get that, because full article is, it's a letter to editor, but whole data was given in that one.
So what do you want to do?
Sir,
you want to get the full paper?
Yeah sir.
Okay. So one of my resident must have written that paper, which was perhaps conducted some years ago. But if it is not available, ask Amit. He will write to the concerned first author and get you the paper. So many residents keep writing their thesis paper. Difficult to follow. No? So we don't even know who is publishing when. So that is access we are working on. It will be already, perhaps they are going to float a tender. And how much time it will take? Tender process, if it is smooth, it may be over in 3 months or 4 months. If there are no objections, but I forgot to ask residents yesterday if they really want any specific electronic textbook, like up to date or Dynamed or anything. We can; those are proprietary. So I have got people, residents particularly, have access in Jipmer, Puducherry, and of course in Ames they have access to this. If our residents want it, Prakriti, can you ask them on the WhatsApp group, which one they want? There are some available. You can ask from your colleagues in other parts of the country. Then whichever is available, we'll make it available. It's expensive, but doesn't matter. Okay, thank you.